You're listening to the audio production of Philippians, Audio Bible Studies by Mark Batterson, published by Harper Christian Resources. The Audio Bible Studies series provides a unique audio learning experience. Unlike a traditional audiobook's direct narration of a book's text, Philippians includes high-quality live audio sessions from the author that cover important Bible-based topics. These sessions will reflect the ambience of the unique recording locations, immersing the listener into the teaching. While not required for the audio experience, these studies are designed to partner with the coordinating study guide, sold separately.
On April 16, 1963, Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. penned an open letter that would become a key catalyst in the civil rights movement. It was powerful not just because of the words. It was powerful because of the circumstances in which it was written. Dr. King wrote that letter from a jail cell in Birmingham, Alabama. Responding to critics who questioned his timing and his tactics, Dr. King said this: "There was a time when the church was very powerful, in the time when the early Christians rejoiced at being deemed worthy to suffer for what they believed. In those days, the church was not merely a thermometer that recorded the ideas and principles of popular opinion. It was a thermostat that transformed the mores of society." Question: are you a thermometer or are you a thermostat? Are you reflecting the attitudes and opinions of those around you, or are you shifting the atmosphere with faith, hope, and love? Let me ask it this way. What percentage of your thoughts, words, and actions are a regurgitation of the news you're watching and the social media you're consuming? And what percentage is a revelation that you are getting from God's Word? Welcome to this six-part study on a book of the Bible that we call Philippians. The audience is the church in Philippi, but Paul is writing this letter from a jail cell. That is part of what makes this message so powerful. It's one thing to write about joy. It's another thing to do it while you're in prison, on trial, chained to Roman centurions. Over the next six sessions, we'll unpack this book chapter by chapter, and in some cases, verse by verse. What I want to do in session one is set the scene. And this is significant. If content is king, then context is queen. There's a very simple principle in hermeneutics, the science of interpreting scripture. Text without context is pretext. In Judaism, there is a hermeneutic called pardes. It consists of four levels of learning, four stages of study. Level one is Peshat. It's the plain reading of scripture. It's reading the Bible devotionally. You don't need a seminary degree to hear the still small voice of the Spirit. That said, Peshat is like the tip of the iceberg. It's the 13% that's above water. We're going to dive a little deeper than that. Now, level two of study is called remez, and it literally means hint. It's the cues and the clues within the text. According to rabbinic tradition, every word of scripture has 70 faces and 600,000 meanings. Remez is turning the kaleidoscope to reveal different facets of truth. The third level is called Deresh, and it means search as in Google search. Duresh is connecting the dots between the Torah and the Sermon on the Mount. It's connecting the dots between the Old Testament prophecies and New Testament fulfillments. It's letting Scripture interpret Scripture. Now, the fourth and final level is called sowed, and it means secret. This is where we need the help of the Holy Spirit. All Scripture is God-breathed. The same Spirit who inspired the writers to write helps readers read. And I might add, we don't just read the Bible, the Bible reads us. The Spirit of God works on both sides of that equation. The goal isn't getting through Scripture, the goal is getting Scripture through us. So, in session one, we will set the scene by connecting the dots. Paul is writing this letter to a people, to a church that he is intimately acquainted with. It's been a few years, but there are memories embedded in Paul's mind, in Paul's heart. As he writes this letter, he is seeing people's faces. He is having flashbacks to moments and miracles that they shared together. Ready or not, here we go. Philippians chapter 1, verses 1 and 2. Paul and Timothy, servants of Christ Jesus, to all God's holy people in Christ Jesus at Philippi, together with the overseers and deacons, grace and peace to you from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. There is some difference of opinion as to when and where Paul writes this letter. Best guess, Paul is writing from a prison cell in Rome, somewhere around 60 to 62 AD. Now, I've been to one of the sites where Paul is purported to have been imprisoned. It's about the last place you want to be. And Paul is not just on trial. It is life or death. Paul is living on borrowed time. Paul is writing with a holy urgency, and you can feel it when you read this letter. So, there is some difference of opinion as to when and where this letter is written, but we know who Paul is writing to. He's writing to the church at Philippi. Now, there won't be a quiz at the end of this session, but this city took its name from Philip II of Macedon, who was the father of Alexander the Great. It was one of his military strongholds in northern Greece. His primary interest was mining for gold and silver in the region. According to ancient records, those mines produced an annual revenue of 1,000 talents. Now, fast forward a few hundred years, and Philippi is conquered by the Romans in 31 BC. So, Paul is writing to Roman citizens. They spoke the Latin language. They wore the Roman dress. Their coins had Roman inscriptions. The city itself was patterned after Rome, and it sat on the Via Egnatia, which was a major military road in the Roman Empire. Spiritually speaking, Philippi had a wide variety of religious influences. There were altars to Greek gods. Archaeologists have found sanctuaries to the Egyptian gods Iris and Serapis. And of course, there were monuments to the Caesars. The imperial cult, as it was called, was the official state religion. Then, you've got this Jewish community that is living in Philippi. It was probably a small number because as far as we know, there was no synagogue in Philippi. If there had been, Paul probably would have gone there. Instead, Paul ends up on the outside of the city where he finds a small group praying on a riverbank. And that's where I want to Duresh. I want to rewind all the way to Acts chapter 16. The book of Acts is the backstory to most of the letters that Paul writes, including this one. Again, he's not writing to strangers. He can see their faces and they can hear his voice. And you can feel the affection in verses 3-8. Paul says, "I thank my God every time I remember you. In all my prayers for all of you, I always pray with joy because of your partnership in the gospel from the first day until now, being confident of this, that he who began a good work in you will carry it to completion until the day of Christ Jesus. It is right for me to feel this way about all of you, since I have you in my heart, and whether I am in chains or defending and confirming the gospel, all of you share in God's grace with me. God can testify how I long for all of you with the affection of Christ Jesus." This is a love letter. In fact, it's a love fest. Paul's affection for the Philippians is palpable, tangible, visceral. Now, if Paul took the Myers-Briggs, I'm guessing he would have been more of a thinker than a feeler. But of all the letters Paul writes, this may be the most emotional. There is this deep-seated feeling in his writing. He's looking back on their shared history from the first day until now. And it's this flash flood of memories. What memories? Well, I'm glad you asked. Paul is referencing what was recorded in Acts 16. Paul is on his second missionary journey, and Philippi was not on the itinerary. Philippi wasn't plan A, it was plan B. It wasn't a destination, it was a detour. Acts 16:6 says, "The Holy Spirit had prevented them from preaching the word in the province of Asia at that time."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.